I'd like to welcome you all to this, the BCS Roger Needham annual lecture, which is sponsored by Microsoft Research at Cambridge. My name is Jeff McGee. I have the privilege to be the current chair of the BCS Academy, and my role tonight is to be a sort of master of ceremonies, so you will forgive me if I make a mess of things. So tonight's lecture is being filmed, and it's good. It'll be on the website shortly after the lecture. So before we begin, can I ask you to check that your mobile phone's turned off, your laptops are switched off so they don't interfere with the filming, and you stalwartly resist coughing and sneezing during the lecture. So now down to this evening's business. The Roger Needham Award is part of the BCS's remit to encourage and recognize personal endeavor in computing science and recognize excellence. The award was sponsored by Microsoft Research Cambridge, and it's established in memory of Microsoft's first director of research outside the UK, outside the US, Roger Needham. So each year it's awarded to a distinguished research contribution in computing science by a UK based researcher who's within 10 years of their PhD. The recipients receive a cash prize, and together with the opportunity to give this public lecture in these glorious surroundings of the Royal Society in London. So, however, this year, before we present the Needham Prize, what we would like to do is take this opportunity to present the BCS CPHC Distinguished Dissertations, highly commended and winner, so both the runners-up and the winner. So I'd like to ask Professor Perdita Stevens to come up and introduce those and to present the awards. Perdita.
Thank you, Jeff. So this year's Distinguished Dissertation competition had 14 entries from universities all across the UK. They covered a bewildering range of topics that really show the range of ideas in modern computer science, from applications in medical imaging and in e-learning for engineering, through networks and visualization, to quantum mechanics and to verification. You might be thinking that 14 isn't very many and that as chair of this committee I didn't have a very difficult job. Nothing could be further from the truth. The number of submissions vastly understates the difficulty of the task of picking a single winner. Universities clearly see how high the standard of the competition is, and every thesis submitted has been endorsed as something special by its examiners, but also that is then reinforced by the international reviewers who examine them. I looked back through the reviews of all the entries in preparation for tonight, and I think every one of them has a review that says that the work is brilliant, that it's excellent, that it's extremely important. So very, very high quality of the submissions this year. I'd like to thank all the people who are involved in doing it, of course the people from BCS and CPHC, especially Diane Geldenhuis, who's been managing all of this stuff behind the scenes, the international reviewers who reported on the theses from an expert perspective, the six members of the committee who had to try to put that all together and compare these very different works with their very different strengths, but especially, of course, the submitters. So let us start off by giving these certificates to the two of the three highly commended theses who are able to be with us tonight. We could have up here Dr. Xie Zhiyong and Dr. Luana Mikalev. And I have certificates for them here. So, Xie's thesis was about pushing the limits of indoor localization in today's Wi-Fi networks, using some very clever techniques and getting the localization down to tens of centimeters in some cases. And Luana Mikhalev's thesis was visualizing set relations and cardinalities using Venn and Euler diagrams. And she showed novel ways of laying out these diagrams and calculating ways to present them, and did a very careful experiment to show the effects of using those different mechanisms on how people could actually use those diagrams, which fundamentally solves that problem. However, after considering the very strong field, the international reviewers and the competition steering committee all agree that Emanuele Dosualdo's thesis is a worthy winner. So if we can maybe have him. Verification of concurrent programs that use asynchronous message passing, which is a paradigm that's important in the web and elsewhere. It shows how to form a decidable abstraction of such programs and justifies the correctness of the SOTER tool, which is the first model checker for an infinite state fragment of concurrent Erlang. The work does not neglect practicality. Emanuele has developed a range of benchmarks that are already being adopted by others. In a theoretically deep second part of the thesis, he goes on to develop a type system that can be used to check that certain programs fall into a class of programs that can be verified, even though they have to be expressed using a finer-grained abstraction than the decidable one treated earlier, moving on from PetriNets to Pi calculus, essentially. Emanuele's thesis will lead to better tools for checking correctness of concurrent programs. And the reviewers also praised the quality of the exposition. So although this is a highly technical field, readers from across computer science will be able to benefit from reading this thesis. This is valuable work that fully deserves recognition as this year's best UK PhD dissertation. So, congratulations.
So first of all, I'd like you to join me in thanking Professor Perdita Stevens and her committee for doing such an outstanding job. And it's a lot of work in the distinguished dissertation panel. So thank you very much, Perdita. And I'd like to ask Professor Philippa Gardner to come and introduce the main event. Philippa chairs the BCS Awards Committee. Thank you, Philippa.
Hello, I'm Philippa Gardner from Imperial College London. Sharon Goldwater is eminently qualified to receive this BCS Roger Needham Award. She is a world-leading researcher in computational linguistics, in particular in the computational modeling of language acquisition, although she has also made significant contributions also to Bayesian modeling and its application to language in general. Her research is widely recognized and acclaimed. I wanted to read out a little portion of from one of the referee letters. Among scholars in this field, her name invariably comes up as an example of someone who successfully connects the computation to the linguistics. She applies state-of-the-art ideas in machine learning to address important questions in cognitive science in a way that is considered legitimate and indeed sophisticated by both communities. Sharon's nomination especially stood out for the warmth of the referee letters. They judge her to be a real star. Congratulations, Sharon. Your award is richly deserved. This award is sponsored by Microsoft Research Cambridge, and Roger Needham was the first director of this research lab. And I'd like to introduce Daniel Tarlow as the representative from Microsoft to come and say a few words and give the award.
It's a great pleasure to be here on behalf of Microsoft Research to present the 2016 Roger Needham Award to Dr. Sharon Goldwater, which was established in memory of the late Professor Roger Needham. Professor Needham was a distinguished researcher in computer science and the founder of Microsoft Research Cambridge. I'd like to take a moment to tell you about him and the lab that he founded. Professor Needham joined Cambridge's computer laboratory in 1962 and became head of the laboratory in 1980. He was elected to the Royal Society, he was a fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering, and he received a CBE for his contributions to computing. In 1997, he founded Microsoft Research Cambridge. Microsoft Research Cambridge was a well-founded laboratory, and it owes much of its success to the path that Professor Needham set it down. The goal of Microsoft Research is to do blue skies research in computing and to turn it into world-leading products. Sometimes the process takes 10 years, and other times it takes 6 months. Microsoft Research is an open research organization, and even when working on research in secretive areas, like the new Microsoft HoloLens product, Microsoft has a history of releasing academic papers after major launches. For example, after the launch of the Xbox Kinect body tracker, Microsoft Research Cambridge released a detailed paper of the system, which has been cited over 3,000 times since 2013. Microsoft Research is committed to supporting young scientists in industry and academia via awards like the Roger Needham Prize and the Microsoft Research PhD Fellowship Program. The Microsoft Research PhD Scholarship Program in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa was launched in 2004 and has so far supported more than 200 PhD students from more than 18 countries and 51 institutions. Today, Microsoft Research is part of the Microsoft Artificial Intelligence and Research Organization, which brings together Microsoft Research with more than 5,000 computer scientists and engineers focused on the company's AI efforts. Natural language processing is a core technology underlying these efforts, and more broadly, it's a fundamental research area in computer science. Dr. Goldwater has made major research contributions to the field, particularly towards discovering computational processes that are needed to learn language structure. It is a great pleasure to present the Roger Needham Award for her many contributions across natural language research. Could I please invite Dr. Goldwater to the stage?
Now she's sitting down because first I would like to introduce Dr. Chris Dyer from CMU and DeepMind to come and give a few words introduction to her lecture.
Good evening. I'm going to keep this very, very brief because I know you're all here to hear Sharon. Briefly, I interacted with Sharon for the first time in about 2008 when I was spending a few months at the University of Edinburgh, where she had just taken up a post as a lecturer, and her guidance and enthusiasm for her work has profoundly influenced me and certainly many others in the field. So it was a great honor to get to introduce this lecture. This is a Computing Society award, and a lot of the talk that Sharon's going to give is going to focus on looking forward and some of the exciting applications that her work is enabling. And so I thought, as somebody who's actually spending most of his time in industry these days, I would instead take a sort of intellectual approach and look backwards and say, how does this fit into kind of the broader context of the history of ideas? So language learning is sort of the quintessential problem that of learning. And sort of Chomsky has Noam Chomsky revolutionized the field of the study of language, transitioning to something about from sort of just rules and grammars that that people work with to a question of how do people learn the languages they speak. And he quoted this eminent member of the Royal Society about this underlying problem of induction, which is that kids manage to learn language so effortlessly from such a small amount of data. And any system that we can build that mimics that or tries to characterize that process falls hopelessly short. And Sharon's work is trying to basically bridge that gap by building systems that succeed a little bit better. Close that gap to children. So the problem of studying a learning system is quite difficult. And Lila Gleitman, who you see shown here, suggested that one of the ways, so rather than trying to solve the scientific problem of induction, which is a sort of hard nut to crack in the history of philosophy, she's instead said, well, let's study devices that that succeed at the problem of induction in specific domains. And she works on the studying how children learn language. And she identified three fundamental questions that we need to ask about a learner in language. And the first of these, is there a systematic relationship between the properties of the input and the linguistic structure? So kids come into the world, they hear people around them talking, and they need to figure out what the rules are that gives rise to this this language. And I'd say Sharon's work has really, outside of all the exciting engineering applications, really shown us a new way to think about this first question. So let me take this moment to read a small quote from Sharon's 2006 thesis, where she says that the work she has presented rests on the assumption that these component problems of language acquisition, that's learning the words, the sounds, the syntactic structure, and the semantics of a language, can't be solved in isolation. And you have to learn all of these things together as one big system. And so here is this kind of figure showing kind of all of these different layers starting up from the sounds of the language down at the phonetic level and moving up through the words and the sentences up to sort of the discourse level. And through a series of ingenious papers, she's shown that you're able to actually both study the system, not just the little layers in isolation, which has been a standard methodological assumption made by cognitive scientists, but you're able to do better when you do this. So some of her initial work put together words and the phrases that they are put together to form to understand better how we might, how children might acquire the lexicons of their language. So basically, she spent a lot of time training models to look at sentences like this, where these were sentences of people speaking to their kids. this work went on to have lead to major discoveries in how to model language in general with significant engineering applications. More recently, she's looked at another pair of levels of this onion, namely the sounds that exist in language and the meanings that they might that they occur with. And using this, this is a plot of sort of where the vowels in the English language are, which is obviously a notoriously complicated system. And she's able to, by putting these layers together, recover this system from unlabeled data. And then finally, a sort of more recent effort is looking at applying this to a more engineering-focused application, namely, can computers learn to do speech recognition using similar techniques without much supervision? And I'd say what's happening here is we're putting together engineering and science to come up with practical applications of unsupervised learning. So I think one of the things that is sort of most exciting about Sharon's work is not only that she has developed models that can sort of work at different levels of representation inside of language, she's also showing that our field, either as cognitive scientists or computer science, works better when the two fields put together, and the same can be said for engineering and science. And I think all of us should take that as a serious lesson. So I think I've said enough, so it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Sharon Goldwater.
Thank you, Chris, for that excellent introduction. And without further ado, I'd like to invite Sharon to come up and give this year's Roger Needham Lecture. Please, Sharon.
Great. Thank you all for coming. It's really a great honor to be here today. And thank you for such a lovely introduction as well. I want to start by relating an experience that I had recently with language technology. I had some relatives coming to visit me from Hungary, and they're in their late 80s. They've lived in Hungary their entire lives. They speak reasonably good English, good enough that we were able to carry on a conversation. But at certain points during that conversation, they had to say something in English and they didn't know how to say that exact word. And so they did something that many of us do these days. They pulled out their mobile phone, they spoke a word or a few words in Hungarian into that phone, and it translated for them. And they were able to show me the result in English. And it worked. And I really thought, you know what, this is amazing. Because when I was in high school, this kind of technology was on Star Trek. And now we actually have it in our everyday lives. And probably many of you are familiar not just with machine translation technology, but you've probably also used technology such as automatic spelling correction and text completion, whether in searches or on your mobile phone. You may have used large vocabulary dictation speech recognition software that automatically adapts to your style and your vocabulary. And probably many of you have also used something like voice-activated search on your mobile phones, which is getting so sophisticated that, in fact, it's no longer just search, but is really more like a personal assistant. And this whole area of developing voice-activated personal assistants seems to be kind of the next big thing. All of the big tech companies are now trying to develop these systems and grab your attention with them. So, as I said, this all seems really amazing. And what I'd like to do today is tell you a little bit about how we got here. How did language technology get to be so good? But at the same time, probably many of you have used some of this technology, and you may also remember that it doesn't always work exactly as you expect. So I'd also like to tell you a little bit about why language technology is still so bad, and what I see as some of the major issues there. And having done that, I can then tell you a bit more about how my work fits into all of that. And as Chris mentioned in the introduction, and as you can tell from the title of my talk, the main thesis here is going to be that I'm trying to work across different disciplines, cognitive science, linguistics, machine learning, language technology, or as we call it, natural language processing in the field, with the basic idea that by taking inspiration from what's going on in human language learning, we can hopefully build better machine language learning systems. But that at the same time, as we're trying to build machine language learning systems, by doing that, we're effectively trying to reverse engineer the human language learner, and we then may come up with new inspiration and new ideas about how that might be working. So, to get to that point, let me start with a very simple example of something that we might want to do with a natural language processing system. And that is, we might want to interpret a sentence. So here's a very simple sentence, find the blue squares. And in order to try to understand that sentence, we could design a system that takes the meanings of those individual words and tries to build them together to capture the meaning of the sentence. So for example, if we look at the word blue, that basically means something like all the blue things that are in this very simple scene. And the word squares refers to all of the square things in this scene. And so if we want to talk about the blue squares, we can combine the meaning of blue and the meaning of square by just taking the intersection of those two sets. And that gives us the blue squares. So that's all very nice. The problem is that if we try and scale this kind of idea up to the kind of language that people really use in real situations, things become a bit more difficult. And one way that things become difficult, that I'll try and focus on a bit here, is in terms of ambiguity. So here's another sentence. I met the woman in the cafe. And in some ways, this has something in common with the previous sentence. There's a phrase at the end of this sentence. I'll refer to this as the prepositional phrase because it starts with a word in that's a preposition. And that bit of the sentence acts kind of like the way that the word blue acted in the previous sentence, in the sense that it modifies the meaning of one of the other words in the sentence. The problem is it's not so clear which other word it's modifying. So it could be that in the cafe refers to the meeting event, right? That meeting event took place in a cafe. Or it could be that it refers to the woman. So I could be walking past the cafe with a friend of mine and say to that friend, oh, look, I met the woman in the cafe last week in the class I was teaching. And this particular sentence actually is ambiguous even to a human listener. But it turns out that there are other sentences that have the same kind of structure and where most humans wouldn't even notice that they're ambiguous, but to a computer, the ambiguity can present a potential problem. So here's another sentence. I met the woman in the blue coat. If I hadn't just pointed out the previous sentence, you probably wouldn't even realize that in the blue coat could, at least in principle, refer to the meeting event, because it just doesn't make any sense. Okay, so here's another couple of examples. I met the woman with the blue coat. Right, so this one basically means the same as I met the woman in the blue coat. But again, we could have that prepositional phrase starting with could also refer to the meeting event, right? I met the woman with LinkedIn. So this kind of ambiguity is the sort of thing that computers need to be able to deal with in ways that mirror the ways that humans deal with them. But it's much more difficult because humans are using their knowledge of the world, and we need to come up with some way that computers can solve this. I should point out that in these examples, the only thing we're dealing with is just the question of where that particular prepositional phrase is attaching. But actually, if we wanted to interpret the meaning of the full sentence, we'd actually need even more information. We'd need to have the full structure. So this is often referred to as a syntactic parse. And if we want to get that full structure, all of a sudden there's going to be even more ambiguity, and it's going to be even more challenging. And I want to point out also that it's not just ambiguity at this level of syntax in order to get meaningful interpretations, but in fact, language is ambiguous at all levels. So another example of ambiguity, a colleague of mine actually said to his computer speech recognition system, we need more psychopaths on campus. Now you might wonder, why did he say that to his computer system? It turns out he didn't actually say that. What he actually said was, we need more psychopaths on campus. But you'll notice that there's an ambiguity in the sound of those words. And in this particular case, the computer got it wrong. OK, so we've got ambiguity in syntax. We've got ambiguity in the sound structure. One other example is we've got ambiguity as well just in the meanings of words. So we could say the bank raised interest. And depending on the continuation of that sentence, it could mean bank raised interest rates by 5%, or it could mean something different, the bank raised interest in its community development program. In fact, there's actually another word in this sentence that's also ambiguous, actually maybe more than one, but one that I know of, which you probably didn't even notice, and that is bank, which could refer to a financial institution, as it does here. It could also refer to a riverbank. But again, as humans, you probably didn't even notice that ambiguity. So how do computers in the current systems that we are using, how do they try to overcome this ambiguity? Well, the way that most of these systems work at the moment is by using a machine learning approach, where there's sort of two phases to this. And in the first phase of that approach, they are presented with a number of labeled examples. So what I mean by a labeled example is that they get a bunch of sentences similar to the ones that I've shown before, although really from a real text, where some human has gone in and actually labeled what the correct answers are. So we could imagine that somebody has labeled in each of these cases, where does the prepositional phrase attach in that particular sentence. And then the goal of the system is to be able to take the examples that it's seen and be able to generalize from those examples to some new sentences that have something in common with the ones that it's seen before, but also have something new. So they're not exactly the same. And the question is, how does it learn to generalize? Well, the way that it does that is by extracting some features that might be shared between some of these sentences and some other sentences that it sees later. So the kinds of features that might be extracted are things like information about the pairs of words that occur in the sentences. So we could look at the pair consisting of the verb at the beginning of the sentence and the noun that's inside the prepositional phrase. And we might notice things like, well, in cases where the verb is meet and the noun is cafe, the prepositional phrase tends to attach to the verb. And that's because meeting events tend to happen in cafes. But when we see meet and coat, well, they don't have much in common, and so that prepositional phrase doesn't tend to attach in that particular situation to the meeting event. Now, of course, none of these features that we're observing is perfectly predictive of what we might see in a new sentence. But all of them have some statistical validity, right? So they all maybe are a little bit informative. And if we combine features like that with other features, for example, we might look now at the earlier noun in the sentence and the noun that's inside the prepositional phrase. And in this case, notice things like, well, actually woman and coat do tend to associate because women sometimes wear coats. We can extract these kinds of features, and by combining all of those features together, we can come up with a system that altogether is able to make predictions reasonably well in new situations. So the kind of big picture of this is that the machine learning, the natural language processing systems, language technology systems that we have today, are using this kind of statistical approach. Right. So they start off in this training phase where they get a bunch of labeled examples like the ones that I've shown before. They extract some features from those examples. They put those features together using some algorithm that I'm not going to talk about, but basically that algorithm kind of smushes those features together in some way to extract what I'll refer to as a prediction function. Right. And that prediction function, we can sort of think of that just as some black box that we can then use when we want to deploy the system. And the way that we use that prediction function in the deployment phase, right? So now what we're trying to do is we're trying to make predictions about new sentences that we haven't seen before, new examples. We don't have labels for them, but we can still extract the same set of features, plug those into our prediction function, and it will hopefully make the right predictions about what the syntactic structure is, what the words are in a speech recognition system, or whatever it is that we're trying to predict. Okay, so this is basically how systems today are set up. And as I said, you know, this works pretty well, especially if you happen to be an English speaker, because much of this research has happened in English, as I'll get to in a moment. So it's a good paradigm, right? It's done a lot for us. But as I said, it does have its weaknesses. So let me tell you a little bit about what I think are some of the weaknesses of this technology. So one of them I've already alluded to, using this example from before, right? Even with this nice statistical setup, you know, these systems do sometimes get things wrong, right? So ambiguity is still a problem. But there's a couple of other things that I'd like to focus on. So one of those is that this type of system is just not very flexible. So it turns out that for historical reasons, as well as other practical reasons, many of these systems have been trained on data that comes from newspaper text, and in fact, often the Wall Street Journal, but other newspapers as well. And so that newspaper text might look something like this. And so all of the examples that have been labeled by humans to give to this system for training look something like that. I shouldn't say all of them, but historically, for a long time, that was true. So the problem is, what happens when you then get some input that looks like this when you're trying to make your predictions? Right? So this is biomedical text. And there's maybe a third to a half of the words in this that probably never occurred in your training data. And, you know, to some extent, this is actually a very hard problem because, of course, even humans maybe don't necessarily know what the meanings of all of those words are. Probably many of you don't. But you can get some general sense of what's going on here. Okay. And you might be thinking, okay, well, this is a very kind of, specific domain. And as I said, it's hard for humans as well. And so, you know, maybe I'm just kind of exaggerating the problem here. But let me show you something that actually comes up every day for many people. And that's this kind of text. Right, so this is from Twitter. And these are people who are living in either Canada or in Scotland. And they're complaining about the fact that their autocorrect system is autocorrecting things that they don't want it to correct. And that's because people like to express their identity by spelling words in sort of non-standard ways in their tweets and in other places on social media as well. And the problem is the computer doesn't recognize that that's what's going on, and it's sort of trying to correct, so-called correct their spelling back to the kind of standard English. And they don't want it to do that. Right, so we have these systems that are inflexible in the sense that they're also trying to kind of normalize everyone back to what they were trained on, and people don't appreciate that. So you might be thinking, okay, well, can't we just solve these problems by adding more labeled data? Right, we could add some labeled data that's in the medical domain. We could start labeling Twitter data. What's the problem? Well, the problem is that the kind of labeled data that we need to train these systems is actually very difficult to obtain. So in a sort of reasonably good situation, what we need to do is we need to just pay people to label data. So if we're trying to develop a speech recognition system, then what we need to pay people to do is to take the audio and to actually just transcribe it. And so that's the labeled data that speech recognition systems are trained on. And that's not too bad because you can kind of get people to do that. You know, anybody can do that. You just need to pay them. The problem is actually many of these systems require more than just paying people off the street. You actually need to give them special linguistic training, right? So I couldn't just take a random person from this audience and expect you to be able to draw a syntactic parse of the kind that I showed earlier in the talk. So because of these issues, it turns out that for many languages, these kinds of labeled resources are just unavailable. And so the question is, how big is that problem really? And what are the consequences of it? So the consequences really are that we have very unequal access to language technology across the world, right? So you guys are speaking English, so you've got very good language technology. And you might think from this, I said, right, Google Translate includes 103 languages. That probably seems like a lot to many people in this room. But let me drill down into that a little bit more and try and convince you that that's not as good as you think it might be. First of all, let me point out that translation technology is actually kind of a best case scenario for what we might expect from language technology systems. And that is because in order to train a machine translation system, the kind of labeled data that you need consists of a sentence in one language translated into another language. And unlike the previous examples of labeled data that I showed where you have to pay people to do this, well, you do have to pay people to make translations, but actually lots of people have been paid to make translations already. The computer company doesn't need to do that, right? There's a lot of data out there. You can kind of scrape it off the web, and you can get data to train your machine translation system. So like I said, this is kind of a best case scenario. Okay, so how good is it that we have 103 languages in Google Translate? Well, let me first of all show you where those languages come from. And you maybe start to see a problem already that nearly half of them are European languages. And believe me, it's not the case that half of the languages in the world are from Europe. Drilling down a bit further, if we look at Asia, it turns out India has 22 official languages. Only 9 of them are included in Google Translate. Looking at Africa, there's 5 African languages that have over 10 million speakers each, none of them included in Google Translate. In fact, if we look at Nigeria, linguists estimate that there are something like 500 languages spoken in Nigeria. And that's clearly a big problem if we've only got 103 languages total. If we look into North America, so none of the indigenous, not just North America, in the Americas, none of the indigenous languages are included. That ranges from things like Quechua, spoken in South America with 6 million speakers, up to endangered languages of North America. And it turns out that overall, there's something like 7,000 languages in the world. So 103 languages is really just a drop in the bucket. Not only that, but many of these 7,000 languages are minority languages, not the sort of state official language, but a language spoken by minority culture, or even endangered languages. And so what we're effectively telling people by not having this kind of technology available to them in their language is that their language is not important. It's not valued in our modern society. And I think that's a really dangerous message to send, both from the perspective of cultural preservation, but also from the perspective of scientific inquiry, because it turns out that many of these endangered languages are actually very important for linguists and cognitive scientists. One of the best ways that linguists and cognitive scientists have to study language and to understand how it works is by looking at language in its all its diversity across the world. So if we're sending the message to people that their language isn't important, you know, those endangered languages are going to die out, and we're going to be losing a big part of that. So this is sort of the problem that we're faced with, right? How can we try and develop language technology in a way that's going to be more universally accessible? So that's the question that I think about in my work. And the reason that this brings me back to the question of human language acquisition is because really, if we're thinking about trying to develop systems that can learn any language, the best way of doing that is by looking at human infants, right? Human infants can learn any language in the world. Of course, they do need to be exposed to that language, right? So just like a computer system, they need data, right? We'll call it training data, if you're thinking in a computer science way. But given some training data, they can learn any language. So the question is the training data that these human infants are learning from, does it look anything like the training data that we're giving our computers? And I would argue, no, not very much. So if we think about the kind of situation that humans are learning language in, right? We've got our parents and we've got a dog here, so there's maybe something else going on in the scene, and the infant is hearing some acoustic signal and sees what's going on and over time kind of learns to associate the signal and figure out what it means and interpret what's going on. Right? So, you know, there clearly is a lot of information here that we could be learning from, but it's quite different in character, and I would argue much less sort of detailed and specific than what our machine learning systems are learning from, which is something more like, okay, here is, you know, my acoustic signal, and by the way, the words that are contained in that are look at the doggy, and here's the syntactic structure, and oh yes, by the way, this word doggy here refers to that thing over there, and it doesn't refer to the thing in its mouth or its tail or something else, right? So we're really giving our systems much more kind of detailed structural information than what we're giving to the infants. So what we want to be thinking about is how can we get back to a situation that's a little bit more like this, where we don't have to give so much labeled data to the machines. And in fact, it turns out that if you look at very young infants, that they're able to actually learn, at least start to learn something about the linguistic structure, the sound structure of their language, possibly even without some of the meaning associated with it. So I'll say a little bit more about that in just a moment. So I've kind of made this argument that we need to be thinking about human language learning. You might be thinking, okay, that's all very nice, but why is that actually necessary, right? There are other kinds of engineering tasks that we've been able to solve without actually looking to the natural solution, right? We solved the problem of flight, and we didn't do it in the same way that birds are doing it. So maybe there's some other way of learning language. My argument against that is I think that actually solving the problem of flight and the problem of language are fundamentally different. So to solve flight, we have to solve something about the physical world, right? We need to deal with things like gravity, aerodynamics, right, things that are out there and obey the laws of physics. Language isn't out there in the world, right? It doesn't obey laws of physics. Language is actually produced by human minds, and it's designed to be learned by human minds and to be processed by human minds. And I think for that reason, really the only way that we're actually ever going to understand and be able to build systems that can do this is by understanding more about the human mind. And so that's kind of what leads me to have this research program of trying to make these connections between human language learning and machine language learning. Now, I've introduced in the beginning of this talk a bunch of motivations for trying to develop more universal language technology, and that is what's driving my research. But I'd also like to just point out that on the kind of scale of where people are, ranging from sort of fundamental science towards applications, most of my research really is more toward the fundamental science end of things. So I'm not going to get to the end of this talk and say, here are six applications that I've developed that solve this problem. Instead, what I'm going to be talking about are some mathematical and computational frameworks that I think, you know, let's say 15 to 20 years out, with various other bits of research in between, could eventually lead to those kinds of applications. So what kind of mathematical and computational frameworks am I talking about? What are these principles of language and cognition that might be important? So the first one that I'd like to talk about is the idea of learning biases. Biases has a kind of bad name. If you read the popular press, bias is usually considered a bad thing, right? We talk about biases as the kind of prejudices that people hold that we wish they didn't. But in terms of learning, it turns out that bias actually can be a very good thing. So let me try and give you an example of how that works. Suppose I have a bag of marbles, and there are some red ones and some yellow ones in this bag, but you don't know how many of each there are. And I pull a marble out of this bag, and it happens to be red. And then I pull another one out, and that one happens to be red as well. And then I pull a third one out, and I ask you, okay, how many, you know, what are the chances do you think that the next one that I pull out is also going to be red? And that's a very difficult question to answer. It's hard to make that prediction, certainly with any sort of certainty, because you just don't know very much about the situation, right? You don't know how many yellow ones and how many red ones are in that bag in the first place. On the other hand, if I pulled a whole load more marbles out of that bag, and this was what you saw, you'd probably be able to make a better prediction about what the next one would be, right? It looks like it's maybe roughly half, you know, 50-50 red and yellow. And this is kind of the situation that our machine learning systems are in, right? They don't know a lot in the first place. And so in order to make good predictions, they have to see a lot of data. And I would argue that in contrast to that, human learners are a bit different. So let me present a slightly different scenario. Suppose I happen to know, or I just tell you ahead of time, that I got this bag of marbles from this store, and in this store, they generally tend to have bags where all the marbles in the bag are either are one color, and in this case, maybe red or yellow. Okay, so I'm not sure what my bag actually has in it, but it could have a bunch of red ones or a bunch of yellow ones. And now if I pull out two red marbles and I ask you what are the chances that the next one is going to be red, well, now you know a lot more about this situation and you can probably say with reasonable confidence that the next one will also be red. So as I said, I would argue that this is kind of more like the situation that, humans are in because we kind of know, and I want to say sort of, it may be that it's sort of built into our mind already as we're born or that we may know this information from previous experience with language. But either way, we seem to be able to know a bit more about the situation and be able to make predictions using less data than a system that doesn't really know what's going on requires to make those predictions. So the basic idea here is that if we have a stronger bias, assuming that that bias is correct, we'll require less data to make predictions, to make good predictions. Now, of course, you could have a bias that's incorrect, in which case you'll make bad predictions, and that's what you hear about in the news. But in this situation, assuming we build the correct bias into our systems, it should make them better systems requiring less data. So let me kind of run through an example from my own research of how we took this idea and tried to build a better system with it. And the particular task that we addressed here was a task that I'll call segmentation. And this is one that actually occurs at a number of different levels of language. So we could imagine that we've got a whole discourse, a whole text or spoken discourse, and we're trying to segment that down into different topics. Once we have audio data, we might also be worrying about taking that conversation and segmenting it out into who's speaking when, right? So who are the different speakers? We might worry about segmenting into speech versus non-speech. So non-speech could be things like coughs and laughs, or it could be background noise. Right? All of those things are important to understand the difference between those things and the speech, whether you're a speech recognition system or a person. Once you've got the speech, you then need to start segmenting that into sentence-like units. We'll call them utterances. And then once you've got the utterances, you need to start segmenting those into words. And it's that last problem that I'll address now. So let me explain a little bit more what I mean about segmenting utterances into words. So this is a task, actually, it's one of the first tasks that infants need to do as they're beginning to learn language. They get an audio signal, and they need to start identifying where the individual words are in that signal. And it may not be obvious to you, but it's actually not where it looks like. Right? So here are some boundaries. These are the actual word boundaries in this signal. And why would the infant want to do that? Well, the reason that they would want to do that is because they need to start identifying where these words are so that eventually they can start to map those words, the word forms, onto the meanings of the words. And you might also be thinking, you know, isn't this kind of obvious? You know, you might even think perhaps there are pauses in between the words because we kind of have this illusion that we can tell where all the words are in the language. But if you think back to the example that I gave earlier, it becomes clear that that's not the case, right? Because actually that ambiguity was between a single word and two words. So if there were an obvious cue as to where the boundary between those words is, we wouldn't have this ambiguity. So as adults, and you know, as a standard speech recognition system that's trained on the kind of labeled data that I was talking about, the way that we can tell where the word boundaries is because we actually know what the words in the language are. So we're kind of using that as sort of top-down knowledge to figure out where the word boundaries are. But at the age when infants are beginning to solve this task, they don't actually know what the words in the language are. And so there's this really big question, how do they start to figure out where the boundaries are if they don't know what the words are? So this is a problem that has been looked at in the language acquisition community for quite a long time. And so there was actually a famous experiment that happened over 20 years now. Well, no, I guess just about 20 years ago. That started to shed light on how this might happen. So in this experiment, the researchers had to kind of scale this down to a laboratory-sized unit of thing that they could look at. So what they did is they created a very small mini vocabulary, right? So they call this little invented language that just has four words in it. And those are the words. And they take those four words and they create a sequence from them. So we could think of this as kind of an utterance or a sentence. And given that sequence of words, you then remove all of the boundaries between the words. You take a speech synthesizer, right, a computer that automatically produces the speech. And you use a computer to do this because you want to make sure that you're going to produce a sequence that only contains the information about the syllables. It doesn't have anything like intonation or pitch or pauses or anything else that might give clues as to where the boundaries are. Okay. So you're going to play this to some 8-month-old infants. And just to give you a sense of what this actually sounds like, I'm going to play an example of this, I hope.
Kiku va ka la tu ti du ba vu, kiku va ki zu du ba vu, ki zu ka la tu ti pi pa lu bi zi da, pi pa lu bi zi da.
Okay, so you can hear that it doesn't sound very interesting, and that's because it doesn't have any of the intonation and all that stuff. You wouldn't want to listen to it very long, and neither would the infants. So luckily, you don't have to play this to the infants for very long. You can get away with just a couple of minutes. And so the question is, if the infants listen to this for a couple of minutes, have they learned anything? Are they able to figure out anything about this language, this little vocabulary that we had? And the way that you test them, right, you can't ask the infants, you know, did you recognize the word? Because these are pre-verbal infants. But you can do something very clever. Instead, you take this, after this so-called training phase, you put them in a testing phase where the infants either listen to words that came from that original vocabulary or something else that I'll call non-words. Okay, so the words, as I said, came from that vocabulary, which means that those sequences of syllables occurred somewhere in this long sequence that they heard. And the non-words that you test the infants on actually also are sequences of syllables that occurred somewhere in this very long sequence. But they occurred in there because they contain the end of one word plus the beginning of another word. Right? So they're not actually words from the original vocabulary. And then you can basically test these infants by just measuring how long they pay attention to the words and how long they pay attention to the non-words. And it turns out that there's a difference there. Right? And so what that indicates is that they can actually tell the difference between the words and the non-words. They've learned something about this vocabulary. So the question is, how did they do that? So the researchers in this original experiment proposed the following explanation. They noticed that the way that, well, actually they didn't notice, they set this up on purpose in this way, so that the words in each case, if you look at the first syllable of the word, like two, it's immediately followed in all cases by the second syllable, p, and the second one, p, is followed by rho in all cases. But once you get to that last syllable, rho, there's some uncertainty because any of the three other words could come after, which means that the following syllable is something that's not 100% certain. And so they proposed that what's going on is basically the infants are learning this statistical uncertainty, right? They're aware that there is this uncertainty, and they're using that to identify where the boundaries are between the words. And if you look at what's going on in real language, not just these tiny experiments, there is this same kind of tendency, right? So, for example, the second syllable of the word pretty is more predictable given the first syllable than whatever syllable comes after it in some new word. But if you look in a little bit more detail, you'll discover that actually, although this tendency is also similar in natural language, it's not really good enough for a system, whether it's computer or probably an infant, to be able to identify words consistently. So one of the things that I started thinking about was, is there some other way that infants maybe could be using this kind of statistical information in a slightly different way to learn more effectively? And what I started thinking about was thinking about words rather than about boundaries, right? Because eventually the infants are going to have those words in order to map meanings onto them. So in some ways it makes sense to focus on the words rather than boundaries between the words. And if we do that, what you'll notice is that if we try and segment this very long sequence into individual words, and we have the correct vocabulary, the vocabulary on the left, we're actually able to explain the entire sequence with just four words. Whereas if we do it incorrectly, it requires a lot more words to explain the same sequence. So at a very, very high level, the intuition is that if we can come up with an explanation for the data that we've observed or the infants have observed with a smaller vocabulary, that's probably a better explanation of what's going on. But we have to make that considerably more detailed in order to actually build a model. So the model that we started looking at was one that is, first of all, I should point out, it's learning now no longer from this very simplified experimental data, but it's learning actually from real transcripts of speech that was directed to preverbal infants. And in fact, it was a phonetic transcription, but because I'm assuming most people in this audience are not able to read phonetic transcriptions, I've written it here just using standard spelling. Okay, so this is actual transcripts of what some parent was saying to their young infant. And the model takes this as input, and it's going to try and figure out where the words are in that unsegmented sequence. And it's going to try and do that by making predictions, right? So just like in the case of the marbles, we're trying to predict what comes next. And the reason we're thinking about that is because if you actually look, there's a very strong set of experiments showing that, in fact, people do make predictions about what's coming next as they're listening to language. Okay, so it's going to try and do this, make these predictions, by chunking that text into words and then learning the probability of each of those words. So we can think of this actually coming back to the marble example, a slightly more complicated marble example. Let's look at one particular segmentation of this text. Right? So if we imagine that our system has segmented the text into words that look like these ones, then the way that I'm drawing this analogy to the marbles is that each time we see a unique word, that corresponds to a different color of marble. Right? So the word you occurs twice in red, and that corresponds to having two red marbles. I haven't actually drawn different colors on those black words. Each of those black words should actually have a distinct color, but I kind of ran out of colors. So altogether, if we look at this particular example, there are 25 marbles that we've drawn out of the bag, and they belong to 17 different colors. Okay, so already you can see that there's one problem here, which is that we don't have a lot of examples of any particular one of those colors, which is already going to start to make it a little bit hard to predict which one we're going to get next. But there's another problem here as well, which is I haven't actually told you how many different colors of marbles are in this bag, right? How many different words are in the vocabulary? So every time we pull a new word out, right, pull a new marble out or see a new word, there's some chance that it's actually an entirely new color that we've never seen before, a new word. So we need to be able to account for that in some way. And then there's something else that actually makes this problem even more difficult, and this is where the marble analogy starts to break down a little bit, but bear with me. Okay, so suppose we had come up with a different segmentation of the same text. If we did that, actually, that same text would give us a different number of marbles. Right? So I've still colored each of the unique strings as a different color, but whereas before we had, I think it was 25 marbles in 17 colors, we now have 21 marbles belonging to 13 colors. So in some way, we don't actually even know how many marbles we drew out of this bag, right? So this is, as I said, where the marble analogy breaks down a little bit, but hopefully this is allowing you to understand that this is not a completely trivial problem. In fact, it's a very underspecified problem. But as soon as we start to see underspecified problems, that's where the idea of learning biases should be able to help us. So what kind of a bias can we add that will allow us to sort of figure out what the right sequence of words is? So the answer, at least in this case, the first part of the answer is Zipf's law. So Zipf's law is an empirical observation that's been made about language. It's actually been known for quite a long time, nearly 100 years. But as far as I know, people weren't really thinking about trying to build this into natural language processing systems. So let me explain a little bit what Zipf's law is. Imagine that we have a very large text, and we count up how many times each word occurs in that text. And then we just rank all the words by their frequency. Right? So the most frequent word is the, and it occurs 1.7 million times. The next most frequent word is of, and so forth. Right, so we have the ranks and we have the frequencies. What Zipf's law tells us is that if we multiply together the rank times the frequency of each word in our text, we're going to end up with, roughly speaking, a constant factor, right? Which is kind of cool. And it turns out if you plot that on a plot like this where we've got logarithmic axes, what you end up with is roughly a line. And this plot was made from English. But the really nice thing about Zipf's law is it doesn't matter if you look at English or German or Spanish or Finnish or whatever language you want, you're going to get something that looks very similar. And once we have something like this where it seems to kind of be relatively universal across languages, that seems like a really good place to look in terms of biases that will help us to learn language in a kind of universal way. So in fact, this was the kind of bias that we built into our system. And for those of you who like to read math, I will give you a very, very high-level flavor of the model that we ended up with. It's a model called Dirichlet process model, or Dirichlet process prior. And I won't go into much detail about this, but basically this is a model that is a probabilistic model that tells us how to predict the probability of the next word in a sequence, given that we've observed a bunch of words already in the sequence, W1 through WN. And it turns out that this model actually solves both of the problems that I talked about. The problem that we need to have some prediction about the probability of seeing a new word that we've never observed before, right? So that's the bottom. So we sort of set aside some probability mass for that. And this Q of W, I haven't really explained, but that has to do with, so that's another probability distribution that's based on the form of the word. And we also have some probability mass allocated to generating a word that we have observed before. So roughly speaking, the probability of seeing a word that we have seen before is proportional to the number of times we've seen it before. So if we build this into our model and we give it the kind of input data that I showed before, it turns out that we get reasonably good results. Whoops, we don't get those results, sorry. Press the wrong button, okay. We get reasonably good results. So what you can see is that if the system is predicting a word boundary, most of the time it's actually pretty good. But it's actually not predicting all the boundaries that we might expect, at least as adult speakers of the language. So that was a pretty nice result to start with. But we thought about this a little bit more, and we were trying to figure out, you know, why is it not making as many predictions as we would expect it to. And the answer is basically that words aren't actually marbles. Okay. So what do I mean? Well, it turns out if we're pulling marbles out of this bag, and I pull a red marble out of the bag, the next marble that I pull out, it doesn't actually matter that I just pulled a red marble out, right? It's the marbles are independent of each other. But that's not actually true of words, right? So if I pull the word the out of my bag, the chances that the next word is something like cat or dog is probably fairly high, and the probability that the next word is something like eat is pretty low. Whereas if I pulled the word to out of my bag, then the word eat is fairly likely after that, whereas cat and dog are not so likely. Right? So unlike the marbles, these words are actually dependent on what came before. And so it turns out that we can actually extend this Dirichlet process model into a model that's called a hierarchical Dirichlet process to kind of capture this effect. And if we do that, then we end up with a much improved system. Right? And so you can now see that the system is actually almost always, although not always correct, about where it's predicting boundaries. So we actually extended this in a couple of other ways as well, and were able to achieve even better performance in certain situations. But what I think was even nicer about this work was that although it seemed, when I first started working on it, like kind of a small problem, this word segmentation problem, it turned out that the ideas and the mathematical framework that we developed here actually ended up making their way into various other parts of NLP as well, into natural language processing. So there were some systems that people developed for machine translation, for syntactic parsing, and some various other tasks that all used these same kinds of ideas. And then getting back to, you know, what are we learning about human language acquisition? We actually also, with some collaborators, I ran some experiments that actually showed that this model was able to predict the performance of humans in a kind of segmentation experiment similar to the one that I showed earlier. And it predicted the behavior better than previous proposals that had been made. So it seemed to suggest that actually, you know, I'm not saying that infants are, you know, performing all of these complicated calculations explicitly in their minds, but that this model does seem to capture the basic effects that are going on. Okay, so that work actually all happened mostly during my PhD and to some extent during my postdoc. So you might be wondering, okay, what have I been doing since then? And I can tell you a little bit about that in the remaining time. So one of the things that I've been working on is taking these same kinds of ideas about segmentation, but trying to work at a more concrete, more realistic level, right? So I talked about segmentation where we kind of abstracted away from the details of the speech itself, right? We were working from phonetic transcriptions. But now we've been working for the last few years on actually trying to build those models that can actually start to segment from real speech data, right? And real speech data is much more difficult because we now need to worry about what's often called perceptual learning in the language acquisition community, or sometimes called representation learning in the speech community, the speech recognition, automatic speech recognition community. Essentially, this is the problem that when I say a word like blue, someone else says the word blue, we recognize that those are the same word, but of course the acoustics are not the same. And whether it's a computer system or an infant, they need to actually start to pay attention to the distinctions that actually matter for recognizing that that's the same word, and abstract away from differences like, you know, perhaps I'm a female speaker and someone else is a male speaker, or I use a particular intonation. In fact, intonation is an interesting case because in English, the intonation doesn't matter to the meaning of a word. But if I happen to speak a language like Chinese, which is a tone language, then the particular pitch or intonation of a word does actually matter, right? So systems need to be able to learn which of these kinds of acoustic distinctions are actually important for distinguishing meaning. And that's this problem of perceptual learning. In fact, let me give another example of this, right? Even if we're learning just about the sounds of the language, an English learning infant needs to identify things like the fact that the L sound and the R sound are actually, again, distinguishing between meaningful words in English, and learn that those are two different sounds. Again, as English speakers, this maybe seems very obvious to you, but it turns out that if you happen to be a Japanese learning infant, you need to learn that these two sounds are not distinguishing meaning in your language. So we've been developing systems for trying to learn about which distinctions are important and which ones are not, using, again, learning this, trying to learn this just from the speech data without labeled transcriptions. And the other thing that that's leading to, of course, potentially, is speech technology without transcriptions. So we could try to develop systems that might work, for example, in a language where there's no written form. It turns out about half the languages in the world actually don't have writing systems. So if we can develop speech technology without transcriptions, that's actually going to be allowing us to develop systems for these new languages. And you can imagine the kind of system that might be useful here. So it turns out that many of these languages, although they don't have writing systems, they may have information being broadcast, so let's say on the radio. And you could imagine developing a system where somebody can speak a word or a couple of words. This is called query by example, right? Let's say we have some recordings of information, whether it's information about health or about crop prices or about whatever it is that you're trying to find out about. And you could speak a word and bring back the audio documents that are related to that query. And potentially all of that could be done without requiring any transcription in the entire pipeline of the system. So this is why this perceptual learning problem is really important. The last thing that I want to talk about is something that I started the talk with, which is the question of meaning, right? I actually started off by saying, you know, we're trying to interpret sentences, but I haven't really said much about meaning so far. So meaning is something that I definitely think about, because that's obviously what is kind of critical in language. And if we look at what's going on with very early infant language acquisition, it turns out that there's actually a lot of overlap in when infants are learning about different kinds of things. So I've talked about learning different categories of sounds, that is distinguishing between different vowels and different consonants. I've talked about word segmentation. Those both come in very early, even before meanings are starting to happen. But actually, the development of those abilities is occurring, sort of continues to occur and continues to improve even after infants are starting to learn about word meanings, right? So it's not a sequential process. So the question is, you know, is it possible, given this large overlap, that infants might be using something about word meanings to try to learn, you know, to be able to learn better about sound categories or word segmentation? So the question that we addressed in particular is how much meaning would actually be necessary in order to improve, let's say, the learning of different vowel categories. Right? So it's pretty clear, for example, that if an infant knows that boat refers to that thing and boot refers to this thing, that's a pretty good indication that O and U should probably be considered different vowels in English because they actually distinguish things with different meanings. But is it possible that an infant doesn't actually need to know already exactly what boat refers to and exactly what boot refers to, and can know something else about the meanings and to still have that inform their knowledge of the sound categories? And in particular, suppose the infant just knows something about the particular sort of contexts that each of these words is being used in, right? So they don't know that boat refers to that specific thing, but they know that boat tends to be used in situations where there's some water and there's this structure floating on the water and there's maybe some people around and things like that. And they know that boot tends to be used in situations where there's rain and there's umbrellas and there's raincoats and maybe they're putting things on their feet and so forth. And if that's what they know, could that still improve their ability to learn about the distinction between those two vowels? So we developed a model to try and look at this question. And in fact, we showed that yes, even without knowing specific word meanings, just knowing which sounds and words are used in different contexts can help with phonetic learning. Now, this is a model, so far, is just a computational model. So it's given us some inspiration to think about what might be going on in infants. But of course, in order to prove that that really is happening in infants, we'd need to go back and design experiments. And this is something that we're thinking about how to do that at the moment. But in addition, we're also thinking about how to design computer systems for speech recognition that might be able to train, instead of training with the sort of standard information that a speech recognition system has, right? So instead of having acoustics paired with a transcription, could we have acoustics paired with some other representation of the meaning? And in particular, what we're interested in looking at is could you have the acoustics paired with a translation of that into some other language? And again, this seems like a slightly weird thing to do, unless, again, to remind you, about half the languages in the world actually don't have written forms, but you could get someone who speaks that language and speaks another language to listen to the acoustics and to translate it into the other language. Right? So we have some information about what the acoustics means, but you know, each individual word in the translation doesn't necessarily correspond to a specific word in the acoustics. All right, so we're trying to think about how to, I actually have a PhD student working on this problem right now. So those are just to sort of give you a flavor of the kinds of things that I've been working on recently. There's many other things as well that I don't have time to get into. But hopefully by telling you all of that, what I've done is sort of made this overall argument that we need to create systems that are better at learning with less explicitly labeled data and that are better at adapting to new styles and new languages. And in order to do that, we really need to consider what I refer to as the only successful language learning device, right? Humans. Most people don't think of them as devices, but that's what they are. And I've argued that building connections between the field of human language learning and machine language learning can ultimately help us design better systems and better understand our own minds. And I just finally want to point out that all of this work is not something that I could have done on my own, and I have many supervisors, many collaborators, and many students that I would like to thank for their work in inspiring me and in many cases doing the experiments that I've talked about, and of course also to BCS and to Microsoft Research and to my colleagues who nominated me in the first place, and to thank you all for coming.
So my personal thanks to Sharon for giving such an accessible lecture in which she managed to restrain herself to only one slide with equations on it, which I thought was a tour de force. So Sharon's willing to take some questions now. There are some roving microphones. Can you give your name and affiliation at the beginning of your question, please? So can I have the first question, please? Philippa, is there a microphone?
So thank you for your talk. So halfway through your talk, you were talking about the Zipf's law and going into the mathematics. And
yes.
Sort of that's where my background's from, so I was feeling very contented and happy. And then you went into this sort of perceptual learning and a sort of very different type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And what does it mean to bring those two together? And how does one... Clearly, your head has to be big and think about them all.
Yes.
And you're clearly giving that message. Mm-hmm. But then what's it mean to pull it together?
Yes. So actually that's a very perceptive question, in fact, because it turns out that most of the, well, all of the work that I talked about in the first part in detail and sort of talking about the segmentation and the Zipf's law and so forth, as well as much of my other work, has been based on these kind of probabilistic models, so Bayesian models and modeling things in that way. And it turns out, actually, this sort of question of perceptual learning is, I've actually started moving into a slightly different kind of model for that. So probably many of you are familiar with, or at least have heard about, neural network models, because they're kind of all the rage now. And that is how people have been doing this kind of task of representation learning. So one of the things that I'm actually really interested in thinking about is how to bring together those two different kinds of modeling. But I'm really excited about neural network technology because in many ways it's definitely pushing the field forward, and it seems to be a great way of doing machine learning. But at the same time, In some ways, it's almost moving in the opposite direction of what I've been arguing here. So it turns out that many of the reason that most of these neural network systems that are, you know, that other people have developed and that are gaining traction, the reason that they're working so well is that they're actually using even more labeled data in order to get those systems to work. And so what I'm trying to figure out is, can we actually use neural networks in ways that still allow us to do it with less labeled data? And that's sort of where that's not where my slide is anymore. Can we start to bring that into the perceptual learning area? And I will say that I certainly haven't solved that problem yet. But it is something that I'm thinking about, is sort of how to bring those two things together. So at the moment, yes, they are actually somewhat distinct areas of work.
Hi, my name is Claudia Schultz. I'm from Imperial College. And I was wondering, you were mainly talking about learning in children. But how about when adults learn a new language? Because I feel like there are a lot of differences. Because on the one hand, they already know one language, so they already know some concepts, I guess. But on the other hand, if I remember correctly, once we learn a language, there are some sounds that we can't make anymore, or that we can't recognize anymore. So how does that relate to your methods?
Yeah, so that's, in fact, the point that you made just at the end there about not being able to recognize or make certain sounds, that's exactly the problem of perceptual learning. So that perceptual learning happens very, very early in infants, where they, you know, where if you're learning Japanese, you lose the ability to make the distinction between an L sound and an R sound. And even as an adult, it's very difficult, in fact, impossible for many speakers to regain that. So for that reason, yeah, I have been focusing mostly on infant learning because there do seem to be these kind of developmental differences, certain things about language that linguists call it the critical period, that there's this sort of critical period early in life where we're able to learn particular things about language that adults just don't seem to be able to learn. Of course, adults can become relatively fluent in a new language. And so, yes, so there is a question of, you know, how are they doing it? And I think some of the ways, you know, sometimes they're doing it in similar ways. If you sort of go immerse yourself in a new country and, you know, learn the language, that to some extent you may be using some of the same strategies that infants are. But of course, adults often are learning languages in much more conscious ways and using other kinds of strategies. And those are things that I'm somewhat less interested in, although to some extent I think those could be useful as well. For example, if as an adult language learner you are reading a text in a foreign language in order to kind of pick up new vocabulary, that is something that actually machine learning systems are doing as well. And so I think that can potentially be a way of doing this, but I think that focusing on the infant and young children is important to me because I think there are potentially things that are going on there that are different from what adults are doing.
Hey, thanks for the lecture. I'm Antonio Filieri, Imperial College again. Apparently we're older. My curiosity is about how much of the uncertainty can be kept in the model and used for decision. For example, children may sometimes realize that they are missing an information in distinguishing two concepts or two words and may ask you to clarify something, or may ask you, can you repeat that? Can you go slowly on this part?
Right.
Or this part is not very clear. How much can we use this kind of active learning, starting from the existing models?
Yeah. Well, so I think it's maybe a little bit more common for adults to do that sort of thing. But you're right that, of course, humans have a sort of interactive ability to ask for corrections and so forth. So yeah. So that's not something that I've done so far. I've done a very small amount of it. Let me modify that to say. But I think that's absolutely right that, you know, eventually we're going to have to be thinking about, you know, having the computer be able to recognize when it's uncertain about something and be able to ask for clarification. Because again, that is clearly an important part of human learning as well. Yeah.
My name is Trevor Nell. My background is in automation. Mm-hmm. My question is this, that you're obviously an English speaker and your research has been done in the English language. Ah. Has that influenced the outcomes if, for example, you'd conducted your research in Latin where the sequence of the words is not as important, or in Japanese where the underlying structure is far more rigid?
Right. Yeah, that's actually a really good question. So the example that I presented was in English, and indeed a lot of the work that I did early on was in English, but actually recently I have also been focusing on, because as you're right, I mean, we want to make sure that we're not just designing systems that work on English, because that's kind of the whole point of what I was saying in the beginning of the talk. So recently, actually, we've been working on some data sets in various other languages. And in fact, there's the, in particular, the speech, the problem of working with speech is one that a number of other researchers have become interested in as well. And so there's now been a couple of workshops and sort of looks like it may become an ongoing thing called the Zero Resource Speech Challenge, where collectively people have been developing a bunch of different data sets that we can start to test on various different languages. So like the first one was using this language called Sitsongo, which is a Bantu language, I believe, spoken in South Africa. A bunch of the segmentation work that I talked about, although the example I gave was in English, actually we have gone off and tested it in other languages as well. And that does actually bring interesting, you know, issues and differences to light. So I think that's a really good point, which is that we need to make sure that we are actually testing these on different languages and not just looking at English. Yeah.
Picking up on an answer to a previous question first, I think the key to learning a language as an adult is often immersion, a word you used. Mm-hmm. I speak as someone who just about scraped basic language qualifications at school, but managed to learn Dutch to the extent that a few times I've had the question asked in Dutch, "You're not Dutch, are you?" So the question I really wanted to ask was, how do you cope with, particularly in English, mm-hmm. The fact that words have very different meanings, so it's often several and quite often contradictory?
Mm-hmm. So I guess there's sort of two parts of that question. One is how I personally deal with this, and the other is how do computer systems deal with it in general? And the second one is actually a bit easier to answer, because I think in most of the systems that I have developed, that particular issue hasn't, because of the kind of task that I'm trying to solve, that particular issue hasn't been one of the major issues. But the question of what we call word sense ambiguity, that is a really big issue in general. And actually, I had to take an example out of my slide due to time, but there was a really nice example in there of from machine translation, right? Which is one of the places where this kind of ambiguity is a big problem. Where in German, there was a particular word that was translated, in fact, in two different ways by the Edinburgh Machine Translation System, which is a state-of-the-art research system, and by Google Translate. So they were both translating it in two different ways, and they both got it wrong. Because in fact, there's a third way of translating that word, which was the right way of translating it. So it's not a solved problem. I mean, one of the ways that computers systems currently try and deal with it is kind of in a similar way to what I was showing. You know, if you see enough translation examples, and you can kind of look at the words that surround the particular word that you're interested in, then you hopefully, your system will start to learn that in the context of particular words, it tends to translate in this way, and in the context of some other words, it tends to translate in the other way. But as I said, it's obviously not always getting those right.
Sorry. I should say, hello. My name's Peter Radford, and I was at one stage one of Roger Needham's students.
Oh.
And at a bit of advice to everybody, if you're using Google Translate, translate it back into the original language and see whether you've got the thing you started
yes.
from. Because at one stage I have absolutely no Spanish. I was using Google Translate to get it into Spanish from English, and it consistently ignored the negative in the sentence. So always retranslate back.
Thank you. Masood Arif, earlier on in your talk you discussed the issue of physical world as well as the human world of languages.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible at all to take into account agency in any of these models?
So this is something that I personally have not done, but there certainly are people in sort of, you know, working in the same general space that I'm working in who are thinking about that. And I think there's a really interesting, both philosophical and practical question there of to what extent you need to build agency into the system in order to really allow it to learn what it needs to learn, right? In other words, you know, does it have to interact directly with the world and have some knowledge about what it has done? So, as I said, it's not something that I've myself worked on, but I think it's an interesting question.
Yeah, I think we have time for one or two last questions. It's up to about two people.
You talked about how the sample data, the training data which you give to your computational models for language acquisition are taken from things like the Wall Street Journal. But you compared it to infant language acquisition, in which I suppose it's commonly observed that infants are typically expressing desire or need or emotion. Mm-hmm. So I suppose it's a deeply pragmatic process for an infant, whereas for a machine it's, I suppose, essentially non-pragmatic. To what extent does that emotional pragmatism factor into computational linguistics as you try to build better models?
Yeah, so I think in some ways this is related to the previous question of sort of, you know, agency. There's other questions about motivation that come into play. I just want to clarify one thing, which is that my own systems I'm actually not building based on Wall Street Journal text, but that many, many computational systems are learning from that. And so one of the things that I have started thinking about is, you know, outside of just the language, what is the information that children are using, and are there ways that we could start to try and build that into systems? So it's clear that, you know, there is some kind of emotional and there's some kind of social, let's call it a reward system, that infants and children are involved in the sense that, you know, if you are able to communicate successfully with someone, you get what you want, or you can express what you want, or you get some kind of feedback like a smiley face at you, or, you know, something like that. And so in some ways that kind of relates to reinforcement learning that you could have in a computer system. So there are ways that we can kind of build in those sorts of rewards in a computational system. I wouldn't necessarily, you know, go as far as to call it emotion, but if you think that emotion is giving you a reward signal, then you can build a reward signal into the computational system as well.
I think there were two hands up at the back, brother. Is there another question there, or is it the same hand? Okay, we have time for one last question. We'll go here.
Your research is all synchronic in terms of segmentation. Do you have any thoughts on diachronic word segmentation?
So let me ask you to clarify a little bit. I mean, so the way I think of diachronic basically means, you know, sort of the way that languages change and evolve over time. I'm not quite sure how that, what you mean by diachronic segmentation, though.
That it changes. So, you know, there are many words that are now just one word that used to be many.
I see.
Or several, at least.
Right, okay. No, I obviously haven't thought about that because you can probably tell from the way that I was asking your question. I think in principle you probably could apply similar kinds of models. The reason, perhaps not exactly the one that I talked about, but in fact, if one of the things that I've been interested in is thinking about, you know, how learning and the sort of representation of the system or the infant does change over time. And if you're modeling things over sort of short time spans like that, in principle, you could potentially use that same kind of model for modeling over much longer time spans. There's, of course, then a question of whether that's actually a reasonable kind of model, because it may be that the processes that change language over very long time spans are not necessarily the same ones that change them over very short time spans. I don't know.
So I think it remains to thank Sharon again very much. Thank you, Sharon. And I'd like to ask Professor Steve Rene to come and propose the formal vote of thanks. Steve.
So at Edinburgh, there is a history, an intellectual history of people working in the interdisciplinary field of language and cognition and computation. And this goes back at least 60 years. So in the 1950s, in the phonetics laboratory in the Department of Linguistics, there was one of the first speech synthesis systems called the Parametric Artificial Talker, or PAT, which was developed by Walter Lawrence and Peter Ladefoged. And you can now see this in the National Museum in Edinburgh, just down the road from us. And this framework continued. So in the 1960s, with the development of artificial intelligence at Edinburgh, and a focus on the links between artificial intelligence and cognition, with people like Richard Gregory and Christopher Longuet Higgins. I was actually, when I was thinking about this, I was looking at the Edinburgh website, the History of AI Act. Edinburgh, which referred to the significant disharmony in those days. Maybe that's not quite so bad now. And in the 1980s, things were kind of invigorated again with the formation of things like the Human Communication Research Center and the Center for Speech Technology Research. And I think one of the important things of having an intellectual tradition like that is that it needs to get reinvigorated, and it needs to be invigorated by asking the key scientific questions. So it's great to develop applied techniques, and it's great to take some scientific advance and to engineer it into things that we all use. But it's also really important that to realize that the applied science doesn't happen with the basic science without the basic science behind it. So I think that Sharon's work on unsupervised language learning and asking these key questions like how can computational systems learn language with such minimal supervision in the way that people do is actually key for developing this tradition. So I'd just like to basically thank Sharon for giving such a fantastic talk, which really kind of encapsulated, I think, some the sort of questions and the way people are trying to think about this and the structures and the approaches that they have to try and answer these questions, and for continuing and developing this tradition of language, cognition and computation at Edinburgh. So thanks.
So it remains to thank my colleagues in the BCS for organising the event in this splendid location, and thank you, Diana Geldenhuis in particular, for producing our schedule and scripts. And also I'd like to thank Professor Philippa Gardner, who chairs the awards committee and does a wonderful job, and it's a lot of work, and who choose the prize winners. So again, thank you very much, Philippa. And as you can see, Philippa likes to have the last word, so I'll yield the stage to you, Philippa.
Actually, one last thing. I just wanted to also thank Jeff McGee. Jeff McGee has been chair of the BCS Academy Board for many years and is stepping down. And in particular, I happen to know that he strongly supports BCS as the professional body of our subject. And in particular, he's extremely enthusiastic about the BCS computing in schools. Now the teenagers learn more about computer science, because what Simon Peyton-Jones in Microsoft Research Cambridge and BCS have been doing. So, and it's quite a fabulous story. But also on a personal note, I'd like to thank him for his enormous support for the awards committee and, for example, for these lectures. He's been super over the years. Thank you. Thank you.